the will of God? What is the will of God? About this world. Think about it. Let's look up the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 7 again. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings, you will not need. Verse 7. Then I said, here I am, it is written about me in the scroll, about me in the scroll. It is written about you in the scroll, in the Bible. I have come to do your will, O God. This prophecy was already filled in Jesus' life. Yes. But once again, this prophecy must be fulfilled
in my life.
In you. Oh, in your life. Oh, okay, very fast. Now, let me introduce you one or two more. My story. And it can be also your story. Okay. It is written about me in the scroll, in the Bible. How incredible it is. It is written about me in the Bible. Amen. Let's look up the book of Isaiah chapter 49. Chapter 49. It is nearly my story. And it can be also your story. Verses 1 through 7. Listen to me, you islands. Hear this, you distant nations. Before I was born, here again, before I was born, the Lord called me. Before I was born, the Lord God called me. From my birth, He has made mention of my name. Verse 2. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. Oh, here is your story. Okay? Your story. Your story. My story. Pastor. Your story. Oh, here is my story. He made my mouth like sharpened sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hit me. It made me in the polished arrow. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. He made me in the polished arrow and conceived me in his people. Verse 3, he said to me, you are my servant, Israel. You are my servant, in whom I will display my splendor, my glory. I'll show my splendor. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Not, you do not say amen?
Amen.
Okay, amen. 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 Well, verse 4, here is also my sign, my thing. But I said, I have labored to no purpose. I have spent my strength in vain and for nothing. Yet what is due me is in the Lord's hand. My reward is with my God. Verse 5. And now the Lord says, the God said, He formed me. He formed me in the womb. Before I was born, He had formed me in the womb to be His servant. Like Jeremiah, huh? To be His servant, to bring Jacob. Oh, surprise. Amen. To Jacob. To bring Israel back to him. To bring Jacob. Yes. In our time, to bring Jacob, Israelite. Now, in our time,
church.
Renew the church.
The church. Christian. Bring Jacob back to him. Nowadays, most Christians, or numerous Christians, are wandering off, because they do not know God. They do not know God in a true sense, in a deep sense. They do not know a lot about God. That's why they are wandering off. Numerous Christians, they do not read the Bible. That's why they do not know God at all. They just go to church every Sunday. And sometimes they pray a lot. For their own sake. For their own purpose. Sometimes they even go to the streets and preach the gospel. Fervently, very hard. But actually, in fact, they do not know God. They do not know God. That's why they are very easily changed. They are very capricious, changeable. Verse 5 again. And now the Lord said, He who formed me in the womb to be His servant, to bring Jacob back to Him. Oh, this is the very purpose I was born. Okay? This is the very purpose you were born. Now you became a pastor. For this purpose. He who formed me in the womb to be His servant, to bring Jacob back to Him, to God, and gather Israel to Himself. For I am honored in the eyes of the Lord. You are honored, very honored. You are very precious person, okay? You are very spiritual person, and you are a very precious person in the sight of God. Do not wander off. Concentrate. Okay? Concentrate. On what? On who? Concentrate on Jesus. Concentrate on the Bible. Concentrate on prayer. Do not go out to make money. Okay?
Yeah.
If you need money, cry out day and night. for the divine head. Do not go out. Do not go out. Do not go out. If you go out, that means you are already caused. You are already caused. You have neglected your office, the divine office, the office, the task given to you from the Almighty God. You are already caused. It is true. So never go out as a pastor. Amen. Amen. Never go out. When I was in the seminary as a professor, I met on a pastor. He told me he gave up receiving reward. The reward, his reward from the church. How could he survive? He made a strong decision not to receive any reward from the church. And he was running out of food. He was running out of food. He and his family were running out of food. But he did not go out to make money. He just sat and lay down and cried out to the Father. He had just one daily food left. Only one meal. He said to him, "So Heavenly Father, this is my last meal. This is the last meal for me and my loving family. If you do not help me, I will die. That's it. If you let me leave, I will leave." And God answered him, "Okay, I will support you. I will support you." From that time on, from here, from there, yes, people support me. Live by faith.
Yeah.
Live by faith.
Yeah.
Do not ask people for human help. You can ask God for the divine help. God can answer you. God can send you some people to support you. You must live by faith. You are already a servant of God, a servant of the Almighty God. God can do everything for you. God can do everything for you. Do not make the Almighty God a very powerless, small God. Do not go out to make money. About the neglected office, there is no forgiveness. Amen. Verse 5, "And now the Lord said, He who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, and gather Israel to himself, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord. And my God has been my strength." Your God is your strength. Your shield, the shield, your rock, your help comes from heaven. Come from the Lord. Amen. My God has been my strength. He says, this is dearly my story, my confession. This is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribe of Jacob, bring back all the Israel that I have kept. I concentrated on making my church, my small church, grow. But maybe the Holy Spirit reminded me of this Bible verse again and again and again. So I started English again. I stopped studying English 30 years ago. After my high school, I stopped. More than 30 years ago, I stopped. Because of this Bible verse, I started again. It is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribe of Jacob, to bring back those of Israel I have kept. It's not enough for you to concentrate on your own church. It's not enough. You must walk a lot. You must walk. You must do a lot of work. You must have a lot of work to do. You must go out and preach the deep past teachings, and you must make disciples traveling all over the world. It is too small a thing for you to concentrate on your own church. At first, I wondered why it is happening to me. But now, I am convinced He has called me. To be a light for the Gentiles. I also make you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring my salvation to the end of the earth. How wonderful it is my life. This verse 7, it is my life. This verse is being fulfilled in my life. Amen.
Amen.
And this verse also must be fulfilled in your life. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 7, this is what the Lord said. The Redeemer and Holy One of Israel, to him who was despised, to him who was despised and abhorred by the nation. This is me. It's written about me in the Bible. To him who was despised, I was despised and abhorred by the nation, by all the people around me, by all the pastors around me. No pastor had noticed me. No pastor had not taken note of me. I was abhorred. I was despised by the pastors around me. The servant of the Lord. Kings will see you in the right job. Kings will see you in the right job. I don't know why, but whenever I read this sentence, I get excited because I can hear. Okay? Because I can hear. Because I can believe. Kings will see you and rise up. Princes will see and bow down. Wow, okay. I will touch it. King will see you and rise up. Prince will see and bow down. Because of the Lord, who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you, He has chosen you and me. How about this? My dear pastors, how about this? The book of Philippians, chapter 3, here is another my story, Elio's story, and Paul's story. But Paul passed away a long time ago. Now, this is my story and your story. Philippians chapter 3. Chapter 3. Chapter 3, especially verse 7. Verse 7 through 14. But whatever was to my profit, whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss. I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. For the sake of Christ. I now consider loss. Whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ, my Lord. Amen. Verse 8, what is more? I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness, of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Amen. Amen. I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake it is very awesome. Very, very awesome. For whose sake I have lost all things. Amen. Amen. For whose sake, for His sake, I have lost all things. Amen.
Amen.
You have lost all things, maybe. For His sake.
Yeah.
Amen. Please repeat after me. For His sake, I have lost all things.
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 Amen. Amen. You must have lost. For His sake, I have lost all things.
For His sake, I have lost all things.
Amen. Amen. How awesome it is. Was that again? Whatever was to my profit, I now consider lost. For the sake of Christ, how wonderful it is. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ is my Lord. My dear pastor, I'm very sorry, but forgive me. You need to realize the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus. You need to realize the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus. Amen. Please say after me. The surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus. The surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus.
The surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus.
Is that awesome? Is that surprising? Surprising. It's not exciting, the surpassing greatness. It's not the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Christ Jesus.
Amen.
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 For whose sake, for His sake, I have lost all things. Let's cry. Let's cry. For His sake, I have lost all things. Let's confess from my deepest heart. For his sake, who loved me and gave himself for me, for his sake, I have lost all things. My Lord, for your sake, who loved me and gave yourself for me, I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the Lord, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ. I want to know Christ in the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sharing in His suffering, becoming like Him in His death. And so somehow attain to the resurrection from the dead.
Okay.
Not that I have already obtained all this. It's my confession. Okay? It's your confession. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already been made perfect. I have not yet been made perfect. But I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus hold of me. I press on, I make every effort, every day, to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus to hold of me, for which he made resurrection. So the brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. Verse 14, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heaven on earth in Christ Jesus. Amen. Now, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me. To win the prize for which God has called me. Heaven on earth in Christ Jesus. Okay? Let's start. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me. Heaven on earth in Christ Jesus. You must memorize. This is a very, very, very important verse. I press on toward the goal to win the prize. To win the prize for which God has called me. Heaven on earth in Christ Jesus. Altogether, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heaven on in Christ Jesus. Once again, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heaven on in Christ Jesus. Heaven on in Christ Jesus. To win the prize for which God has called me. I press on toward the goal. Without seeing the Bible. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me. Have more because okay, you can do it. No, how about you? Try it. Yeah.
I press on towards the goal to win the prize.
I press on toward the goal to win the prize.
I press on towards the goal to win the prize. And which God has called me in heavenly.
Okay.
In Christ.
Okay. How about you? Can you? Okay. In a loud voice. Memorize. Not just memorize, but pour it to the chest. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me. Heaven on in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let's start all together. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heaven on in Christ Jesus. Amen. This is our daily life. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me, for the very purpose God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. All of us, here 14, if you find out in the Bible your story, you can live very, very awesome, very awesome, wonderful Christian life. Amen. To the extent you can make the Bible your own, so you must clearly know, you must fully realize the Bible is your You can find out in the Bible, among the Bible stories, humorous Bible stories, your own story, if you can, your faith becomes really awesome, really powerful. So now I am telling you, the Bible is your not story. Now, the Bible is your
life.
Already, you can find out your story. See, some stories, or maybe many stories. But now, I'm telling you,
Bible is a textbook.
Textbook.
Yes.
Not that textbook. Okay, except my story. The Bible is a very book containing my stories. So now we can make a conclusion. Not a conclusion. The Bible is your
This Bible is
okay, this Bible is my treasure box. Why, there are many treasures in the Bible. Oh, this Bible is my treasure box, my treasure store. My treasure box.
The Bible is my treasure box.
Please repeat. The Bible is my treasure box. If you can realize, you will be the best. If you can realize, but if you cannot realize, you are so slow. but maybe this time you can clearly realize, and you will be really surprised. You will get excited and you will cry out, oh, the Bible, this Bible is dearly my treasure box. Amen. 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 So, let's go. I have come to do your will, O God. If so, what is God's will? What is God's will?
One more.
What is God's will? About this world. About this world. About this world. What about on this world? About in the world. God's will. God's will. The answer is, God's will is? I already told you. And when Apostle Peter confessed his great confession, who do you think I am? Peter confessed him. Oh, you are the Christ. You are the Christ and the Son of the living God. Jesus was so much glad. Blessed are you, son of Jonah. I tell you, that you are Peter, rock. That you are Peter. And on this rock, I will build my church. God will is to build his church, Christ's church. On this rock, I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not overcome it. So God will to build up the church of Jesus Christ, the church of Christ, which cannot be overcome, by the devil. By the power of the devil, by the authority of the devil, by the power of this world, by the power any governments of this earth. Amen. But nowadays, as all of you know very well, many numerous churches were closed. Human churches are already closed. And so many churches in African countries, also in Asian countries, are becoming superstitious. And so many churches in European countries and the United States of America are becoming secular. So, what is it? The will of God in our times. Maybe to renew, reform, in a true sense, reform, deal. The house in Jerusalem. Jerusalem. Verse 7. After much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them. Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles might hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe. God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them. He accepted them, Gentiles, by giving the Holy Spirit to them just as he did to us. He made no distinction between us and them, for he purified the heart by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of the disciples a yoke that neither we nor our fathers have been able to bear? No, we believe it did through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved just as they are. This is a very, very historical moment when Apostle Peter declared, verse 9, he made a distinction between us and them Gentiles, for he purified their heart by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on your necks the disciples of yoke that neither we nor our fathers have been able to bear? No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved, just as they are. We must accept Gentiles who believe in Jesus by grace through faith. And 15, so 14. Simon has described to us how God at first showed his concern by taking from the Gentiles a people for himself. The words of the prophets are in agreement with this, as it is written. After this, I will talk and rebuild. After this, I will talk and rebuild a fallen tent. It's ruins. I will rebuild and I will destroy it. That the remnant of man may seek the Lord and all the Gentiles who bear my name, say the Lord, who does these things that have been known for ages. The new time started for the church to accept Gentiles. So, the new history of the church of Jesus Christ has started. They made a conclusion to accept the Gentile believer. Now, maybe, it's time for us, true pastors, to renew, to restore, able to reform, rebuild the churches, the fallen churches, or the corrupted churches, or even superstitious becoming churches, secular becoming churches. It's time for us, for our true pastors to renew, restore, even to rebuild the churches in the world. Amen. Maybe it is the will of God. We have come to know the will of God. Okay, let me explain about the church chapter later. Number one, the more stories in the Bible you find out, and your stories, the more powerful, Remember, the more stories in the Bible you find out, oh, here is my story, here is my confession. It is my own confession. It is my prayer. My own prayer. It's not Elijah's prayer. He passed away long ago. Why it is written in the book for me? It is my prayer. For example, the first Kings. Chapter 18, verse 36 and 37, number 2. For example, whenever early kings, chapter 18, verse 36 and 37, the Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today, that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and have done all these things at your command. I dearly want God to testify about this ministry. And I dearly want God to testify that I am His servant and have done all these things at His command. Not on my own. So it's my let it be known, it's my prayer. Okay? Do you see? My point, this is my prayer. Oh, it's dearly my prayer. And it can be also your prayer. Amen. Do not just say amen. It can be it must be your prayer, my prayer. It is my prayer. I am convinced it is my prayer. Do you see what I am saying to you? Yes, it is my prayer. Oh, really, it is my prayer. It is my confession. Let it be known, it is my great desire towards God. Father, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, in the world, and that I am dearly your servant. And I have done all these things I have done until now, all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord, answer me. So these people, will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again. I have come here, I have come on this earth to turn the hearts of the children of God, turn the hearts of the children back again to God the Father. I have come on this earth to do this will of God. Amen. To come back all the Christians who are still wandering off in the world. I have come to turn back all the Christians, all the wandering Christians, to come back to God. Amen. I clearly know I have come to do this purpose. This will of God. How about you? Even pastors are wandering. So I have come on this earth to turn to turn all the Christians, including some pastors, to turn all the Christians, all the wandering Christians, back to the Almighty God. Okay? Amen. Amen. In other words, to renew, to restore, to rebuild the church of Jesus Christ in the whole world. I don't know until when I can be used, but God knows if my time, if my time finishes, your turn. Answer me, O Lord, answer me. So these people know that you, O Lord, are God, that you are turning back your heart back again. It's my story. It's my prayer. It is my confession. It's my great desire. Here is another my great desire, another my deep hidden story. As I told you, I have asked myself, Who am I? Who am I? I asked myself for a long time, at least more than 10 years. Why? And I told you, God reminded me again and again. God said to me again and again, over and over, on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. So, I have asked myself, why this is happening? What God wants me to do? I asked him, Father, what do you really want me to do? Father, I'm ready to do. What? Answer me, what do you want me to do? Maybe some months ago, I found out the answer. Oh, here it is written about me. In the Bible, how awesome it is! How terribly awesome it is to find out the very story, my story, the story about me in the Bible. Amen. And your story also is written in the Bible. This is also your story. You have come from this source to do the will of God. My dear pastor, you were born to do the will of God. Do not wander off. Yes. Do not go out to make money. Yeah. Concentrate on God. Concentrate on prayer and the word of God. Amen. I, however, you are told, follow the Lord wholeheartedly. So on that day, Moses swore to me the land on which your feet have walked will be your inheritance, and that of your children forever. Now then, as the Lord promised, He has kept me alive. He has kept me alive for 45 years. So here I am today, 85 years old. I am still very, very, very awesome, incredibly awesome. I am still as strong as the day Moses came down. I am still as strong as the day, as the very day Moses sent me out. I'm just a vigorous powerful heaven sent him. I am just as vigorous as go out. Not to make money. Go out. To go out to battle now. Battle. To go out to battle now as I was then. Awesome. Incredibly awesome. Now, give me the hill country. Give me this hill country. That he promised me that day. You yourself bought them, that the Amalekites were there, and their cities were large and fortified. But the Lord helped me, I drive them out. Amen. And he was follow the Lord wholeheartedly. God will give you everything you need. God will give you everything you ask him for. Amen. Let's live by faith.
Amen.
Let's live by faith. And you must clearly realize you have come to do the will of God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's get back to number one. The more stories in the Bible you find out as your stories, the more powerful your sermons, the more powerful your preaching are supposed to become. Once again, the more stories in the Bible you find out as your stories, the second, the more intimate fellowship you can have with the Almighty God, the Holy Spirit. Again, the more promises and what command you can think as those given to you. The promises or command given to you. The more awesome faith life, you are supposed to lead. Amen. Amen. It is really true. It is my life. It is my confession. It's my life. It's my faith. It's my experience. It's my daily life. Oh, everyday life. The more awesome faith life you are supposed to lead. How wonderful it is. But you are not surprised at all. So tired? Exciting? Are you excited?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, you are the best. For example, when I read the King, chapter 18, verses 36 to 7, the Lord God, for Abraham, Isaac, Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant. And have done all these things as your command. But you must prove that I am your servant and have done all these things. Answer me, O Lord, answer me so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God and that you are turning their hearts back away. This is my purpose. This is the very purpose I have come to this world. Hebrews 10 verse 7. Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, O God. It is very, very awesome, incredible, terribly awesome to find out my story written in the Bible. Amen. Amen. Number 3. It was terribly a great shock to confirm the reason why I have come, why I was born on earth. I don't know exactly since when, but anyway, I'm holding a fire, a flame, a great fire. But to me, this is not likely to be extinguished. until it burns up the whole world. A burning fire, a burning fire, a burning desire. This belief I have to know why that has been so. I clearly know, perhaps, you also the same fire in a deep heart, in a soul, which will never be extinguished. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Escape from your, from the distraction, distraction. Concentration. Okay, concentration on Jesus, on the Bible. Concentration. Concentration on the Bible. Concentration. And spend a lot of time with Jesus. That is so sweet. Concentrate on prayer and the Word of God. And spend a lot of time with the Lord, with the Holy Spirit. Sometime later, you will be a great pastor. A dearly great, I mean, you will be greatly used by God. You will become a great pastor, not in the sight of human being, but in the sight of God. Amen. This belief I came to know why that is so. I clearly know perhaps you also the same fire in the deep heart, in your soul, which will never be extinguished. The problem is you are too much distracted by many things to do, by many things to be done, to be prepared. We can make sure. Luke chapter 10, verses 38, 42. You are worried and upset. You are worried and upset about many things, about many things. You are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Only one thing is needed. That is to listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. In order to listen to the voice from heaven, you must concentrate. In order to listen to the voice from heaven, what you need the most inspiration. One thing is needed for you. Passion for inspiration. Concentration. You can put one more. Concentration. Passion for inspiration. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.